People tend to think that what happens in the Arctic stays in the Arctic, or what happens in the Antarctic stays there. And it doesn't, of course, it's a larger system. Normally, when we think of mosquitoes, we think of hot summer days or a lot of wet sort of rainforest type of feel. And we don't think about frozen ice and glaciers and lots of cold water. But that is because actually the Arctic and the Antarctic, as they change, as they warm, they actually ramp up the weather elsewhere. They change the temperature, they change the humidity, and they also have extreme weather events, which actually leave a lot of water coming in from cyclones and hurricanes, and all of that is really fertile ground for mosquito breeding. We've got West Nile, we've got Zika virus, we've got dengue, and we've got Lyme disease, which comes from ticks. All of those things have breeding grounds, and as climate changes, and certainly in the Africa region, we're seeing that ramping up in terms of malaria and dengue, but it's not just Africa, it's also Southeast Asia and increasingly North America and Northern Europe. As a Canadian, I certainly grew up with a lot of mosquitoes when we went to cottage country just north of Toronto, but absolutely never did I worry about things like West Nile virus, nor did I ever worry about Lyme disease from ticks, and that has completely changed from when I was a child. Northern Europe and the healthcare system are not used to diagnosing cases of West Nile or of dengue, that's for sure. That being said, they're a fairly strong, robust health system. What is not robust are marginalized areas around the world that are quickly going to become overcome by surges in vector-borne diseases. And I think that's where the real risk comes in. There's two things that the government should do. The first is take it seriously. Really start now by building their risk and response plans for these emerging healthcare risks. And secondly, what they need to do is they need to invest in cross-national, multilateral vaccine preparedness and medication so that we can actually deal with this when it hits. The more we talk about climate change, the more we talk about the risks to the things we love in our day-to-day life, the more actually we can build a community and a culture that is really ripe for climate action.
When patients come to see us, it's really important that we actually take care of them and see them and meet them where they're at. If we even wince or look at them with a sense of puzzlement or ask them questions that are truly inappropriate, like, why did this happen to you? Why did your parents do this to you? This is horrible. Any of that terminology is blocking access to healthcare. Those patients will never come and see us again. So when I first began the clinic, I wanted to make sure that we had interpreter services, nutrition that actually gave advice on foods that people from cultures and countries actually eat, not American food with big, you know, hamburgers and french fries. I wanted to make sure that they, as they walked in, they didn't feel uncomfortable when they were in the actual clinic room. So we provide robes that are cover a little bit more. I think the onus is on the way we train our physicians. I think our medical schools and our residency programs really need to have a consistent method of educating that includes compassionate care, culturally sensitive care, the actual equity of care. And I think if we are able to ingrain that early in our training programs, I think the outcomes really do spread to many other areas, even if a provider decides to be a private practitioner. I think that we have to think about investing in women in all aspects, be it research, be it high technology, be it ensuring that our patients don't have to come to the hospital. So prevention. And I think that the ideal way is to find an actual healthy population where most of the patients don't have to come to the hospitals at all. And they can get that kind, compassionate care where they're at.
Get to build your robot, you get to fix things, like fix problems as they come up. with it. You're not sitting there writing down notes the whole time.
The most important thing we can do is make school relevant to kids. It's when they wake up and say, I want to be there.
This is our favorite class. It's as fun as it is a learning experience. I love coming to this class every day. I love my classmates, all my peers.
It's much more entertaining because it's more hands-on.
There's a tiny bit of stress for trying to find a job after high school. You know you're gonna have to find one, but we also don't have any work experience as of right now. All we have is school experience. So this kind of helps with that in the sense that like we're doing more hands-on work and actually getting to know what it is to do more the physical work rather than just writing on a piece of paper all day.
We need to transform the practice of education so that we're focused not on math and English test scores, but on the kind of skills that kids need to know and be able to do in the 21st century, a century that is riven with robots and AI and huge transformational changes. So we need to actually focus on things like problem solving and critical thinking, resilience and relationship building.
Most of us want to get into an engineering or STEM field, so having this class is kind of like a stepping stone.
We need to really reconceive education, and particularly high school education, so that kids have choices about whether they want to go to college initially, or whether they want to go into the field of work, or just have lots of life skills. And that conception is how the Micron Project started. Because if you believe that kids should be in the driver's seat for the kind of education they should have, and they should have choices, then you understand that when we're bringing back semiconductor fabs and manufacturing to the United States, a place that started semiconductors, then you need to skill people for these jobs, not just for engineering jobs, but for the technical jobs. And you need to make those technical jobs valuable, not something that says an afterthought.
It changes many people's lives. It changed my life to be able to know that there was a place for someone who is going to be able to learn better, you know, making something, creating something, tinkering, putting it apart, solving a problem, putting it back together. To have that equally accessible to all of our students through public school systems, it's not only just going to benefit our schools, this is going to be able to benefit the greater society, because we already know that technology is evolving at an exponential rate.